Now, when I discuss the first unit of inorganic that we need to deal with, the first, very first part deals with bonding. Okay, so there are two concepts in bonding. One of them is called as VBT and the other one is called as MOD, abbreviations, valence bond theory and molecular orbital theory. We'll be discussing both of them in detail. And the second part of the unit deals with ionic compounds. So when I talk about bonding, I'm basically going to be emphasizing on bonding in covalent compounds, because when I say valence bond theory or molecular orbital theory, it will be extrapolated more in the regions of inorganic compounds which are covalent in nature. The next part of the unit deals with ionic compounds, wherein you will be coming across things like, some things that you've already done, like shapes of lattices. You've done that, right? FCC, BCC, simple cubic, hexagonal closed packing, and all the CCP, cubic closed packing, and so on and so forth. So a little bit touch up on that, and then we'll straight away move to lattice energy and the other parameters associated there, right? What will come at the bridge between these two is a concept called as hybridization, which will come at the brink of these two topics, that is bonding in covalent compounds and properties of ionic compounds, basically, let's say, okay, broadly. Now this hybridization is something that is commonly misunderstood. Okay, the idea behind framing of the syllabus was that when you had the same kind of topics in your FY, now all of you have had a course in tetrahedral carbon or square planar geometry or trigonal planar geometry, trigonal bipyramidal geometry, etc. Right? I think Shipra ma'am dealt with that last year. Unfortunately, Shipra ma'am will not be engaging lectures with you this year. Okay. So the other six of us will be actively involved in discourse of theory. Of course, Shipra, you will see Shipra ma'am in your practicals when you go back to the lab. Or when you come from the lab, I should say, because now you're not going back to the lab, you're coming from the lab to the class, right? How many of you are used to getting up at 6 o'clock in the morning? Fine. The others have to get up. Because from 22nd of June, I hope you know that, from 22nd of June, you're going to be starting with your practicals. You'll be seeing more of me in class and you'll be seeing less of me in the lab. As per the timetable that has been framed, I'm going to be there in the SY lab only once in a week. That will be on a Saturday. Saturday means the batch which is biotech chemistry and microchemistry combination should be the ones who should be coming in on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. So I'll be there only on Saturday. Rest of the days you'll have Sangeeta ma'am, Shipra ma'am, Dasgupta ma'am, all the others coming in for you for your practical course, right? Now what I was trying to tell you with this about, can I have you back here? Okay, so what I was trying to tell you about hybridization was, last year when you had this course on molecular geometry, it was categorically told during the syllabus discussion that you were to be told only with respect to the VSEPR. What is the full form? Valence shell electron pair repulsion. Okay, so the molecular geometries were not to be associated with some hybridization schemes like sp3. So when I start with my course here, I will assume that you don't know sp3 means tetrahedral geometry. Okay, that was not the idea behind the way the syllabus was framed. The idea behind the way the syllabus was framed was that in FIBSC, you just know that when there are three electron pairs, then it should correspond to a trigonal planar structure, not because it has an sp2 hybridization, because you don't know anything about hybridization, but because in the valence shell electron pair repulsion theory, you need the electrons to be farthest away as possible from one another. And due to that, you need the geometry to be something called as a trigonal planar or something called as tetrahedral and so on and so forth. Is that absolutely clear? So we are going to be discussing some basic hybridization schemes starting right from sp3 to sp2 to sp. And we'll also be moving to certain higher hybridization schemes which involve the d orbitals like sp3d and sp3d2. Okay, so you were not expected to know all of this from the FI point of view. In fact, we were told not even to mention S and P to you in FIBSE. Okay, we were just asked to mention the molecular structures based on valence shell electron pair repulsion. How can you sum up that theory in just one line? How can valence shell electron pair repulsion theory be summed up in just one line? You have this golden rule. This is the essence of valence shell electron pair repulsion or VSEPR. That's it. There is nothing else to the theory except this, that lone pairs will repel one another to a greater extent as compared to the bond pairs. So therefore, the repulsion between two lone pairs will be greater than a lone pair and a bond pair, and a lone pair bond pair repulsion will be greater than a bond pair repulsion. And therefore, two bond pairs can be pushed closer together at the expense of giving the lone pair more space. And that is the reason, if you look at CH4, which is methane, and if I draw a three-dimensional view, two of the bonds are along the plane of the board, one of the bond is coming out of the plane of the board, one of the bond is going into the plane of the board. This structure, I mean, it has been validated through X-ray crystallography, etc., that the bond angle in this structure is exactly 109 degrees 28 minutes or 109.5 degrees, right? So that means this is a perfect tetrahedral structure. However, when you go to a molecule of nitrogen, the simplest of which being ammonia, you will see that the bond angles get shrunk together. So that means these bond pairs are pushed closer together in ammonia as compared to what they are in CH4, right? So here the angle is 109 degrees 28 minutes, but here the angle gets reduced to 107 degrees. Now this is where your VSEPR comes from the picture. I have not discussed hybridization at all. What do I attribute the change in angle to? I only attribute the change in angle to the fact that lone pair requires a larger space as compared to the bond pair. So what does the lone pair do? The lone pair pushes the bond pairs closer together, and because it's pushing the lone pairs, bond pairs closer together, therefore the bond angle seems to be reducing a little, right? Go to another molecule. Now, what you will come to realize is that all these molecules have, in a sense, the same hybridization scheme, but I have not yet started discussing that, right? Let me talk about another molecule, which is quite a favorite, a molecule of water, which is a universal solvent. Now, when you look at the bond angle between the HOH bond, it happens to be 104 degrees. So that means these two hydrogens are being pushed even closer together as compared to the bond pairs in ammonia, right? Now, what exactly do you attribute that to again? There are two lone pairs on oxygen as compared to one lone pair on nitrogen in ammonia. Because there are two lone pairs, these two lone pairs will have a greater spatial requirement as compared to a single lone pair. And therefore, it's pushing the bond pairs further closer together, and therefore the bond angle is seen to shrink further to about 104 degrees. Is that clear? So what you were expected to know when you come here for an SYBSE class is only this. You are not expected to know that the hybridization of carbon in methane is sp3. You're not expected to know that the hybridization of nitrogen in ammonia is sp3. Neither are you expected to know that the hybridization of oxygen is also sp3. Is that clear? That is what we will be discussing now in this year. The only thing that you were expected to know is the geometry based on VSEPR. Is that clear? Okay. Now, before we move on to bonding, there's something in the syllabus which has not been specified, which I feel is utmost necessary for you to understand a course in bonding. Because when we move to bonding, you will come across something called as wave functions of the electrons, right? We have some wave particle duality which is going to come in, there'll be wave functions, there'll be interaction between wave functions. Sometimes it'll be constructive, sometimes it'll be destructive, just like two waves interact with one another, right? But before we move on to all this, it is very important to understand what is an atom. Okay, what is the structure of an atom? Because without a structure of an atom, we can't move forward to a structure of the molecule, right? So which were the earliest attempts towards structure of an atom? Okay, we can date back further from Rutherford. There were Greek philosophers who discussed, some were of the belief that you don't have anything called as an undivisible kind of a particle, okay? There was one line of Greek thinkers which felt that you could go on dividing matter infinitely and still you would get the same intact thing. I take a bread, I break it into half, it still remains bread. I break it into one-fourth, it still remains bread. This was the reasoning behind the Greek philosophers. They said you can go on dividing matter indefinitely. But there was one more line of Greek thinkers which thought that you cannot infinitely go on dividing matter. There should be some limit that should be reached that beyond which you cannot divide matter. Okay? For a long period of time, there was battle between these two, but nothing came forward. Okay? Until Dalton. Dalton was the first one who talked about atomic theory, said that atoms were the smallest indivisible particles of which matter was composed of. Any matter, whether you talk about solid, liquid or gas, will be composed of smallest particles called atoms, right? But nothing more was known about the atoms. A little later, there was a scientist by the name of J.J. Thomson. How many of you know J.J. Thomson? Okay, I've heard of him. Don't know him. Of course, he lived way back. You know your friends, you don't know J.J. Thomson, but at least heard of him. So, J.J. Thomson was the first one who discovered something very phenomenal. It was due to his cathode ray tube experiments that he discovered electrons, okay? So that's when he said that, or he visualized, that an atom need not be indivisible. Atoms could also be composed of certain subatomic particles, and therefore there came to be a view of line of thought which said that electrons and protons make up the atom, which we know of it. How did protons come into the picture? J.J. Thomson was not involved in proton. He was not involved in anode rays at all. Anode rays came later. But J.J. Thomson could infer that atoms were made of protons as well as electrons. How is that possible? Exactly. An atom is electrically neutral, right? So if you can get electrons out of atoms, atoms can only be held electrically neutral if there were equal number of protons in the atom, right? So that is the level of foresight which those scientists exhibited when they were trying to find out the structure of the atom, right? But soon after, anode rays were also discovered. And the first, what was called as the first model of atom was proposed, which is called as the plum pudding model, right? The plum pudding model, I don't know what is the, there's also another name for it, which is called as the watermelon model. I think that we associate with more. The English people will associate more with the plum pudding model. Probably we are, especially in this heat, probably we'll associate with watermelons a little more. So when you break open a watermelon, you will see that there are seeds which are interspersed all over, right? So that was the proposed structure of the atom, wherein J.J. Thomson said that electrons are just dispersed all around the atom, right? And protons and electrons are going to be placed at some distance so that they don't come and annihilate. What do you mean by annihilation? When proton and neutron comes together, there is an explosion. Proton-electron interaction is going to lead to a lot of massive amounts of energy that is going to be liberated from the atom, right? Now, why exactly was that necessary? If you keep a proton, say, over here, and you keep an electron over here, the proton and electron are not going to remain at that distance from one another. Because you have a golden rule of thumb which says that opposite charges and like charges, right? So when you have a proton and an electron, obviously they will come and merge into one another and they will annihilate the atom. Is atom stable? It is stable. Your chair and your tables don't just randomly explode. How I wish the boys would be thinking, how they wish that everything just exploded. Some fascination with boys and explosion. But however, despite that, we know that atoms are quite stable. All the atoms have good length of stability. So to account for that, what was proposed by Thomson was, if I have an electron on this side and an electron on that side, then the charges will get balanced out on either side and therefore they will remain at mean positions from one another. So that was pretty straightforward to conceive that the structure of the atom was such. Till a gentleman named Ernst Rutherford came in, who said that this was not the picture of the atom. What were the experiments that he performed? Okay, so his experiments were called as the alpha scattering experiments. He took a gold foil which was extremely thin. Why was the thinness of the gold foil important? What was his assumption? His assumption was that if I go on taking a thinner and thinner gold foil, I will reach a point wherein the gold foil would be assumed to be just one atom thick. Of course, in principle, if you can't have one atom thick layer, but it was fairly only a few atoms thick. Okay, and it was very, very important because if you have a huge slab of gold, there will be one atom here, one atom here. So what will happen? There will be nuclei everywhere. So what would happen? When it would strike, majority of them would have bounced back. But what was the observation of Rutherford? Majority of the rays actually went through. Very few were deflected. And one in some 10 to the power 6 or more were bounced back from the gold foil. And therefore, the thinness of the gold foil is an extremely important precondition to his results, to his findings, right? So once he did his experiment, he proposed the new model, which was that the protons should be concentrated to a very tiny space in the atom. In fact, now we have some correlations. We don't really know how small the nucleus is. So some people have come up with some analogy. Okay, what is the analogy? How many of you play cricket or know what is cricket? IPL just finished, so we know what cricket is. You know how big a cricket ball is? Okay, you place the cricket ball at the center of the pitch, okay, in a cricket field. If the ball is the nucleus, then the whole field is the atom. That is the correlation between the size of the nucleus and the size of the atom. So you can see how much of the atom is just filled with empty space, and only a small area right at the center of the atom is having some mass. So the mass is seen to be concentrated at the center of the atom. Is that clear? Now, what is the problem with this model? If you have all the protons at the center and you have electrons here, why should the electrons stay at the periphery? The electrons should just come running down to the proton because opposite charges attract, and the matter should annihilate again, which is contrary to our observation. So what came next? A brilliant physicist or chemist. Now there is a thin line of divide here. When we are discussing atomic theory, we take all of them to be chemists because we want to associate with them. But actually, atomic structure is a very, very foolproof and well-studied part of physicists. Basically, all these people like to be known as physicists rather than chemists, but we take some amount of credit. Okay, they are partly chemists as well. So what did he propose? He proposed something called as the planetary model of atoms. What was that model? He said that these electrons were not static. Why were they not static? If they were static, it would go and annihilate the atom. So what did he say? The electrons are actually going around the nucleus like the planets are moving around the sun, right? And this way they can help in balancing the forces out. What are the forces which are acting? There is an attractive force, right? The centripetal and the centrifugal forces. And there will be a force which will be pushing the electron outside the orbit, okay? So when both of them balance each other out, you get something called as a stationary orbit. So each orbit is associated with certain energy, right? Now, at this stage, the physicists thought, we banged it. Yes, this is the structure of the atom. There is no other, we've reached the pinnacle of science and we know everything about atoms, till when certain other scientists started proving that the structure is not quite true. Okay. One of the most pioneer scientists who said this structure could not be true was Maxwell. Does anyone know what did Maxwell propose? What were the findings of Maxwell? Okay, why would that happen? If the centrifugal and the centripetal forces are going to be balanced, why would you get what he is talking about is spiraling of the electron into the nucleus? So what Maxwell proposed was, say for example the electron starts from here, it takes one complete orbit and its radius of the orbit is going to shrink by a certain extent. And this way it is going to show a spiraling effect and ultimately go and meet the nucleus and there is going to be an explosion. By this measurement, Maxwell actually measured and said that if this was the structure, then the atom should explode in 10 to the power minus 8 seconds. That's it. In that much length of time, the atom should just explode by the electrons coming and meeting the protons which are there at the nucleus. Now, why exactly should this happen? Maxwell found a typical property of any charged particle. Whenever a charged particle is allowed to migrate in the presence of an external influence, it could be an electric field, it could be a magnetic field, it always emitted what are called as electromagnetic radiations, right? Electromagnetic radiations. Now these electromagnetic radiations, when they are emitted from the electron, what is it going to do? It's going to decrease the energy of the electron, because electromagnetic radiations are also energy, and energy can neither be created nor be destroyed. It has to be taken up by the electron itself. So because the energy is decreasing, the radius of the orbit will decrease by a certain fraction. There'll be more emission of radiation, further there'll be shrinking. And so much so that it'll go and meet the nucleus. right? So the whole concept of having stationary orbits wherein the electrons are rotating around in that fixed region around the nucleus went out of the drain. Okay, few other scientists came up with what was called as quantization. Now, where exactly did we get this idea of quantization? Now, there's a huge debate between physicists who believe in the classical regime and the ones who believe in the quantum regime. We are now in the quantum side now. We know that the quantum mechanics is something that is far superior than the classical mechanics, right? So what were the three very, very important experiments which kind of hit the nail on the coffin of classical mechanics? There are three of them. What are they? The first one is BB radiation, not blackberry radiation. What radiation? Black body radiation. Then you have the photoelectric effect, which was given by Einstein, very famous Einstein. And you have the Compton effect. Each of them were the final, you know, the final paths which the classical mechanics took, beyond which only the quantum regime has you know, survived till now. Okay, now what exactly was all these three to do was they proposed that energy is not going to be flowing in a continuous fashion. Energy has to be available in discrete packets called as quanta, and that quanta came from Max Planck's very famous equation called E is equal to h nu, where h is called as the Planck's constant, nu is the frequency of radiations, right? So based on this, we know that energy is associated with small packets of radiation is associated with small packets of energy called as quanta, right? So that's where we started thinking in the quantum world and stopping to think in the classical regime, right? Another person who was very, very instrumental in developing quantum mechanics, there were two of them. One was Heisenberg, okay, and the other one was de Broglie. What did Heisenberg propose? What did Heisenberg propose? Okay, simultaneous determination of two variables which are related to one another cannot happen with arbitrary precision. Now this is the terminology which a physicist will give you. What do you mean by arbitrary precision? Arbitrary precision means absolute value, that there is very, very small value for error. Now if you remember last year, whenever you came to the lab and you wrote your Burette reading as 8, at least I must have definitely corrected that and written it as 8.0, right? Whenever you write your any reading that you obtain in the lab, there is always some error associated with the readings. And the error is always at the least count of the instrument that you are weighing or measuring it. Okay? So when you write your Burette reading as 8, then the error becomes 8 plus or minus 1 cm cube, which is a huge error. But the instrument that you used, the glassware that you used, had 10 divisions between 8 and 9. Right? So when you write your reading as 8.0, that means the reading is 8.0 plus or minus 0.1. So the error is much less when you write the reading as 8.0 as compared to when you write it as 8. Do you understand that? So that is what we mean by precision, that there is uncertainty only in the least count of the instrument by which you are making a measurement, right? So what exactly was Heisenberg trying to say is that if you want to measure the momentum of a particle, and at the same time you want to measure the position of the particle. Now, momentum is given by P, which is nothing but a product of mass into velocity, right? So you just have a product of mass and velocity. If you want to measure that against the position, then you will not be able, there won't be, if one of the variables is measured to a great precision, there will be a huge uncertainty in the other. Okay, so you can't have conclusively say that this is the position of the particle and this is its velocity. If you say this is its velocity, there will be a huge error in the measurement of position. Okay, now how can you visualize this? Now you have subatomic particles, electrons are subatomic particles, right? How will you be able to visualize a particle? When a photon or a quantum of light goes and hits the particle, only then will you be able to see the particle. Am I right? Okay. Now, when the photon goes and hits the particle, since the particle is so small, the particle will gain energy from this photon. And therefore, as soon as you've made the measurement of position, its momentum has changed. Earlier, the electron was moving in this direction. Okay, say for example, this is the trajectory of the electron. Let's just assume. As soon as the light comes and falls, you've measured this is its position. But earlier, the velocity was in this direction. Now, the velocity will change to this direction. And therefore, you have no idea whatsoever as to what its velocity could have been at that same instant of time. Please remember, simultaneous is the most important word in Heisenberg uncertainty principle, that you can't simultaneously measure with arbitrary precision both the position as well as the velocity. Is that clear? So this limitation is not a limitation of instruments. It's not that we've not made sophisticated enough instruments that we cannot do this. But it's an innate property of matter that you can't measure these two properties irrespective of how precise the instrument is, right? So it's an innate limitation of matter, okay? At the same time, de Broglie was someone who associated with something called as matter waves, okay? What is the equation associated with de Broglie? Does anyone remember? Lambda is equal to h upon mv, also written as h over p. Okay, where you can calculate the wavelength associated with a particle which is moving, and therefore it is called as matter waves. Now the boundary between wave and particle was very, very diffuse. Why? Because you have particles which are moving at a very high velocity, which will also have some property which we traditionally associate with a wave. Do you ever, when you are talking to one another, you might be asking what's your height, weight, etc. You never ask what your wavelength is, right? Though you want your wavelengths to match. If you're sitting with one another, you want your wavelengths to match. But that is not a property you associate with particles. Wavelength is a property that you associate with waves. Okay? And waves in our head is very, very different from what a particle is. Whenever you start browsing through any videos on quantum mechanics, they'll always give you this visualization. They'll say that whenever you say the word particle, and if you have some miraculous way in which you can go into somebody's head and see what they are thinking, then the first thing that comes into their heads is a billiard ball. Okay? Rigid, hard sphere like that. So when I say particle, the first thing that comes that we visualize is a hard, rigid ball which we associate with, which is like a billiard ball, and we say that is a particle. And whenever we say wave, then the first thing that comes to our head is a ripple on water. And how exactly can these two be the same things is something our mind cannot perceive. Because a wave is a wave, it's a diffused object. A particle is something like a billiard ball, it's a hard sphere which has properties like mass, which has properties like volume and things like that which we associate. Whereas waves have properties like frequency, wave number, wavelength and so on and so forth which we associate with, right? Yeah, there's still time. Okay? So that's the reason we are unable to process this in our heads as to how these two could be the same things. But de Broglie was the first one to put it up that if you have a sufficiently small massed particle which is moving with an appreciable velocity almost close to the speed of light, then you would get a wavelength which could be measurable. Okay? Now do this exercise at home. Take this equation, put the value of Planck's constant, which is of the order of 10 to the power minus 34, 6.626 into 10 to the power minus 34. Take your weight here in grams, okay, and take your velocity, the fastest that you can run, and try to judge what your wavelength could be. Your wavelength would be of the order of 10 to the power minus 30 or 32, which is something which you can't measure at all. 10 to the power minus 30 means 0 followed by 30 zeros followed by a digit, which is something which you can't measure at all, right? Do the same thing for an electron whose mass is in of the order of 10 to the power minus 31 kilograms, okay, and which is moving with a velocity of nearly the speed of light. You can take half the speed of light as well. You will see that now the wavelength starts to look like a value which you can measure in the lab, okay, which comes in the nanometer region or in the angstrom region, which is very much measurable by all our methods. Do you understand that? So that is where the divide between particles and waves was broken down. And then we came into the quantum mechanical. Why exactly am I emphasizing on quantum mechanics is when I deal with valence bond theory, you'll come across this famous psi. In fact, you're going to sigh each time I talk about psi, because this is something which is a little difficult to conceive, but I want you to understand. Okay, see, all of you will probably be interested, probably not today, but maybe in few lectures down the line, you'll be interested in what will be called as your class test. okay? And you'll be interested in what exactly is going to be asked in the class test, how much am I going to score, and so on and so forth. But initially, at least, I'm going to be moving about in this area wherein you will be clueless as to what I'm going to ask. Because what have I been discussing today? Can you frame any question from whatever I've talked about? It's just generally I'm trying to build up for what you need to understand for VBT. Okay? Remember that when it comes to VBT, we'll always be looking at wave functions, interactions of wave functions. So if you don't understand this wave function properly right now, you will not be able to step into the SYBSE syllabus. That do the first unit of paper 2. You understand that? Okay? So try to get this fellow and don't sigh whenever you see this sigh on the board or in your notes as well in future, right? So when it comes to the quantum regime, we have a few quantum numbers associated. Now if you realize I have very, very skillfully omitted the very, very scary Schrodinger in the middle and directly moved to quantum numbers, because Schrodinger happens to be a very scary guy. He was a mathematician and a brilliant mathematician of his time, who was way ahead of his time, did all the work, and till today all his work stands true. Any inference of quantum mechanics that you take, any measurable quantity that you take, it always complies with the Schrodinger's wave equation, okay, which we will kind of touch upon in the future. But right now we are just moving ahead, and we are assuming that Heisenberg, de Broglie and Schrodinger together led to the formation of the wave mechanical quantum model of the atom. Okay? And what was then realized was that there were a few quantum numbers which were associated with electrons in an atom. Okay? Now remember that when you talk about quantization of electrons, if I just fling an electron at you from here to your place, that electron is not quantized. That will have every possible value for energy. It is an unquantized electron, right? But as soon as you take the electron and put it in a bound state, what do you mean by a bound state? You have the nucleus in the center and you have the electron which is somewhere around it in the form of a cloud. Then there comes the concepts of quantization. Because now, and in this scenario, your electron cannot take all the values of energy. There will be certain restriction to the amount of energy that the electron can hold at various distances from the nucleus. Is that clear? Now, what are the very famous quantum numbers that we know of? We know of N, L, M, and S. Okay? In maths, whenever we start with a derivation, we always say, assume X is equal to something. These quantum numbers are not assumed. Remember, when the wave equation was being solved, okay, all this was happening on paper. Nothing was happening with respect to going to the lab and seeing certain properties. All that was already known. What happened? All this happened on paper. What was done was, when the wave equation was solved, these quantum values automatically came in. You could not go ahead with the solution if you did not introduce N. So this is something which is naturally, innately present in an electron which is there in an atom. It is not something that we have tried, not because you say that the electron belongs to the first principle quantum number does it do so. Because it is so, when you calculate, when you try to solve the wave equation, you can't do so unless and until you impose this quantization. And when you impose the first quantization, and this is in the order which they appeared. Which was the first quantum number which appeared? Say, for example, you're solving a mathematical problem which extends to 4 pages long. Okay? At the end of the first page, you had to introduce this. It was a necessity. You had to introduce a quantum number called N. And that quantum number had some restriction. What was that? If it is not restricted, then it's not a quantum number, right? If you can take any values, it's not a quantum number. What is the restriction on L, N? The restriction is that it should be a real number, right? It can have discrete values of 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on and so forth, but it cannot have any other values, okay, in between. Then, say for example, you've solved the first page, now you're moving to the second page. At the end of the second page, there is a necessity that you have to introduce the azimuthal quantum number L. And what is the condition on the azimuthal quantum number? The condition is that it can have values from the values of L are restricted to 0 to N minus 1. Okay? So what came first? While solving the wave equation, N came first. Once N came, in the next page, what You were forced to introduce L. Now take a moment back and imagine, why is it that for principal quantum number 1, you only have 1s? Why don't you have 1p, 1d, 1f, and 1h, and 1g, and so on and so forth? Why don't you have such orbitals? The orbitals are a property that come directly from the azimuthal quantum number. Because the principal quantum number talks about the energy. The azimuthal quantum number talks about the shape. And when I say s orbital, there is a particular picture in our head which is spherical. When I say p orbital, there is a particular shape in our head which is dumbbell shaped, and so on and so forth. So where does the shape of the orbital come from? Who directs? The azimuthal quantum number L directs the shapes of the orbital, right? Now, what are those values? When L is equal to 0, the shape of the orbital looks like an s orbital. When L is equal to 1, the shape of the orbital looks like it is a p orbital. When L is equal to 2, it looks like a d orbital. When L is equal to 3, it looks like an f orbital, and so on and so forth. Is that clear? Now, what are the values for L when n is equal to 1? What are the values of n, L? 0 and 0 to n minus 1. What is n minus 1? 1 minus 1 is? So you have 0 and 0, which is 0 only, right? So since you have only one value of L and that value is 0 for when n corresponds to 1, you only have 1s orbital, you don't have these. Do you understand that? Do you understand how L is totally dependent on n, right? When n is equal to 2, you have the 2s orbital, you also have the 2p, but do you have the 2d? You don't have the 2d. Why? Because when n is equal to 2, the values that L can take are 0 and 1. That's it. The value L is equal to 0 corresponds to an s orbital. The value L is equal to 1 corresponds to a p orbital. Right? Okay, so that's how we build up that typical table, which is called as the Aufbau's table. You have 1s, 2s, 2p, 3s, 3p, and so on and so forth. Right? Now, then where does this m come from? Have you ever wondered, why is there only 1s orbital, but there are 3p orbitals, and there are 5d orbitals, and there are 7f orbitals? Who determines them? The magnetic quantum number m determines that. Now, since each quantum number is dependent on the predecessor, even m is going to be dependent on L. And what is that dependence going to be? M can take all quantum values between minus L to L. And when it contains values between minus L to L, the total number of values that m can take will be 2L plus 1. Can you tell me how? If I have the value of L to be 2, what are the values of M? Let's count. What is minus L in this case? Minus 2. Minus 1. 0, 1 and 2. So why do you have 2L plus 1? This plus 1 is to account for the 0. Right? So when you have the value of L to be 0, how many values of M do you have corresponding to that? Does minus 0 and plus 0 make any sense? So there is just one value for M when L is equal to 0. And therefore you have only 1s orbital. Okay? When the value of L is 1, the values that M can take are minus 1, 0 and plus 1. And therefore there are 3p orbitals, because L is equal to 1 corresponds to p. When L is equal to 2, you will have 5 values. Minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1 and 2. When L is equal to 3, you will have 7 values. Minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, 2, 3. Is that clear? So each of them are interdependent on one another. Okay. When they knew these three, they thought that they had pretty much known everything about the atom. It took some time between coming from the magnetic quantum number to the spin quantum number. Because spin is not something which we can see very readily. But there were two effects. I'm sure you must have heard of the names of them. They are called as the Zeeman effect and the Stark effect. Of course, you must not understand anything about that. But it basically involves splitting of the lines which appear on... So atomic structure is a very fascinating subject, but you need to have an aptitude for the subject to like it, right? So based on these two effects, there was one more quantum number which was proposed, which could take only two values. What were the values? Plus half and minus half. So you would have spin paired or spin unpaired, wherein there will be paramagnetism, diamagnetism, and so on and so forth, which will come. Okay. So that is the brief of atomic structure that you have. Is that clear? Very heavy. Okay, I'll not begin with VBT, but what I want you to do is I want you to look at all the animations for each and every orbital that you see. Okay, why I want you to do that is because it will help you dissociate from the typical mindset, which makes you feel that when you draw an S orbital like this, you assume that the electron is present here, which is going on circling around the nucleus. If you imagine that, you're going back to Bohr's model, because it was the Bohr's model which said that the electron is present at a fixed distance from the nucleus and it is going to be moving around in revolving kind of motion, right? What exactly does it mean when you put a circular picture to the S orbital is that the probability of finding the electron is maximum within this sphere and it goes on decreasing outside. Okay, so maximum points are going to be obtained here. What do these points represent? You have a wave function which describes the electron in the S orbital. You solve it, you get a solution. Okay, so say for example the electron is moving. You have seen the electron. So what is going to happen? This will be one of the points in that particular contour which you've drawn of the electron cloud. Okay, you let the electron free again and again you try to measure. You make infinite measurements, not one or two. You make infinite measurements and go on plotting each and every measurement that you see on this. And when you do that, you get a shape which looks roughly spherical like this in the three dimensions. When you do the same thing for the P orbital, you get something which looks in the shape of a dumbbell. That doesn't mean that the electron first revolves here, meets the nucleus and then comes back here. It doesn't mean that at all. Okay? That's why I'm asking you to go ahead and see the animations, because it tells you that these are just representations of change in the signs of the wave function. So an S orbital will have a different kind of vibration. A P orbital will have a different kind of vibration and so on. Okay? So we meet again next week.